Hi, you're watching Swords, Skulls and Strongholds on the Time Team official YouTube channel with me, Tony Robinson. Britain is a land of monuments and buildings stretching back over 7,000 years, and in many ways they reflect the history of its people. Symbols of empire and civic pride from the proud Victorians. Elegance and proportion were defined by the tasteful Georgians. And the Tudors built palaces for prestige. Roman architecture asserted military might, power and civilization. Even our prehistoric ancestors left their mark on the landscape with stone circles, mounds and tombs. But the biggest man-made monuments in Britain belong to one of the most mysterious periods in this country's past. These are relics of almost 1,000 years of mystery, superstition and violence. The Iron Age. But for centuries, these huge monuments have been ignored or misunderstood. Now though, with new excavations and new ideas, we can at last come face to face with this huge chunk of our lost history. The landscape of Britain is littered with thousands of mysterious mounds. But most of us wouldn't really know they were there at all. They blend into the landscape just like the hills they are, or rather were. Look more closely and you realise they're astounding pieces of civil engineering with imposing man-made ramparts and grand entrances. They're organic monuments of Britain before the Romans arrived. But for all their size and sophistication, it's only recently that archaeologists have really begun to understand why they were built. From the beginning of the Bronze Age, around 2,500 years BC, nomadic hunter-gatherers were beginning to live together on Britain's earliest farms. Their pioneering use of bronze tools gave its name to this era. And centuries later, in the Iron Age, farming techniques were accelerated with the development of a tougher, more available metal. And what's more, the population was expanding.
You've got to bear in mind that by the beginning of the Iron Age, the whole of the British landscape had been cleared of trees, you know, laid out with fields and roads and trackways. It would have looked remarkably like the landscape looks today.
But for a long time, even scholars had no idea that these massive strongholds had their origins in the Iron Age. Why? Because the first archaeology enthusiasts adored the Roman period. Antiquarians, as they were known, were 18th and 19th century gentlemen scholars who were steeped in the history of classical Rome and Greece. Many believed that before the Romans arrived in Britain, we were little more than a bunch of savages, and so completely incapable of creating such colossal structures.
Most antiquarians assumed that anything with this amount of engineering had to be Roman. And being Roman, these monuments could only have one purpose. They had to be military. So the antiquarians called these structures hill forts.
The antiquarians were mystified and overwhelmed by the size of these earthworks, and so did little more than poke around for finds to furnish their own collections. It would be another 100 years before archaeology, as we recognise it today, could offer some explanations for these man-made monuments.
It was General Pitt Rivers, the sort of father of good excavating archaeology as we know it today, who in the 1880s decided that the only way you could find out more was to excavate. And he started a series of excavations in Sussex, and that thread of excavation was taken up in the 1920s, particularly in central southern Britain, by archaeologists who moved every year from one hill fort to another, cutting slices through the ramparts, and that provided the database from which we have built.
Pitt River's excavations produced a wealth of Celtic finds, so he was the first to recognise that hill forts weren't Roman, but came from the Iron Age, a time of savages, if those antiquarians were to be believed. but Pitt Rivers still believed these monuments were forts. They fitted in not only with his own military experience, but also with Roman histories. The most famous British hill fort is here at Maiden Castle in Dorset. It's fantastic, isn't it? You've got to admit, it does look like a fort. Maiden Castle encloses a space the size of 50 football pitches. When it was built, it was designed to be noticed for miles around, as these chalk banks and ditches and the maze-like entrances at each end would have been white. This place also has the distinction of being ransacked by the future Emperor Vespasian during the Roman invasion in AD 43. In the 1930s, Mortimer Wheeler, the leading archaeologist of his day, excavated Maiden Castle. Like Pitt Rivers, he was a military man, an artillery officer, and like most archaeologists at that time, he interpreted things by his own experience. Wheeler found clear evidence of occupation. Down there, he also discovered a huge battle cemetery dating to the Roman period. And nearby, he unearthed a gigantic cache of these, stones for hurling in slings. There's no doubt this was ancient artillery. But this interpretation of hill forts has itself been under attack. For the last 30 years, archaeologists have been re-evaluating Britain's hill forts. And with the benefit of new technology, they're approaching these huge structures in a completely different way. Maiden Castle was re-excavated.
I think it's about prestige. And
this time by Iron Age specialist Neil Sharples. What he found was fascinating. Neil, you don't think this place was military, do you? You think it was a town. And yet Mortimer Wheeler found evidence of a battle here.
Well, he didn't really find evidence for a battle. He found skeletons of dead people buried in a cemetery, and it was an established cemetery. And they were buried very carefully positioned in the normal rite for this group of people. And so it's very unlikely that it's a battle scene.
Yeah, but just because Mortimer Wheeler got the interpretation of one part of the site wrong, it doesn't mean that the whole thing wasn't necessarily a fort.
Well, I think if you look at this plan here, you can see the dense occupation that covers the interior of the fort. The streets, all of these white blobs indicate pits and houses. This is a densely occupied settlement, full of masses of people. Yes, it's protected by these banks and ditches, these ramparts, but this is a settlement with protection, not a fort with a garrison.
So it's not a fort?
I don't think so. I agree. These banks and ditches are for protection. If I was going to build a fort here, I'd build a lot smaller one, more powerful, up one corner.
So hill forts were created long before the Romans, and their purpose doesn't even appear to be military. Why were hill forts so important to Iron Age people? Why did they put so much effort into sculpturing hills? The answers to those questions could rewrite history.
If you want us to investigate more sites, you can make it happen. So, help us reach 10,000 members on Patreon.
For centuries, monuments like this were thought to be military fortifications built by the Romans. Early research established that they were pre-Roman, dating to the Iron Age. But recent work has shown that they weren't military either. Now, exciting new ideas are developing about these fantastic pieces of civil engineering. The most thorough and extensive excavations of any Iron Age hill fort have been at Danebury in Hampshire.
Just over there, past that steps.
It's here that Britain's most distinguished archaeologist, Barry Cunliffe, first lifted the lid on one of the darkest and most misunderstood eras of our history.
people had been digging little holes into Iron Age hill forts, and that gave us a level of information, but it was difficult to get beyond that. And I felt that if we really stayed with this one and worked year in, year out on it and got a big sample, we would be able to start answering some of the big questions about the Iron Age and not just the little ones.
Over 30 seasons of excavation, both inside and outside Danebury, produced a wealth of discoveries that contradicted the traditional view that hill forts were no more than forts on hills.
Did people actually live here?
Yes, there were a lot of activities going on that you would associate with living there. People built houses, they rebuilt houses, one on top of the other. The houses had hearths in, there was a lot of food refuse around, they had ovens, they stored things there. There was a blacksmith at work and a bronzesmith at work and all these things. So lots of things going on. What we can't say is that they lived there absolutely continuously, year on year or day on day.
For the first time in Britain, a profile was emerging of people who were nothing like the stereotypical bloodthirsty warlords that featured in the Roman histories. Barry Cunliffe had discovered the remains of an ordered society where people were living and worshipping in an early kind of town and leading lives as craftsmen and farmers outside. And all of this hundreds of years before the Romans brought their version of civilization to Britain. This little meandering path does actually delineate the Iron Age entrance, doesn't it?
It does. It's exactly where the road that you would have taken in the Iron Age goes, and it goes right through the gate and into the interior.
What might somebody have seen if they were coming up here during the Iron Age?
The main gate was a big, impressive gate between the ends of the ramparts there, with a tower across it. Once they got inside, they would have seen this sort of network of pathways spreading off, and just around the insides of the ramparts, circular houses, thatched, daubed, and then rows of storage buildings and a temple or shrine in the middle. Almost certainly elaborately decorated, I think. That's guesswork. Archaeologically, we've got are the holes where the timbers were and the clay that they smeared on the walls. But occasional traces of white paint, occasional traces of red. I like to think of them as elaborately painted.
And the people coming out of those houses, what would they have been wearing?
Almost certainly woolen clothing. We would guess that it was dyed and probably woven in a sort of plaid way, so it would have looked rather like a Scottish or Irish tartan. Leather used a lot for belts and probably shoes and leggings, that kind of thing.
Long hair and beards, do we think?
Oh, always long hair and beards, yes.
So they look like archaeologists.
But droopy moustaches, you know, Celts and droopy moustaches. There's a Roman writer, Diodorus Siculus, who talks about the Gauls and their long, droopy moustaches and says they're so long that when they drink, they strain their drink through their moustaches, which is quite nice.
Most hill forts are much smaller than the grand edifices of Danebury or Maiden Castle, and yet archaeologists working on these are finding similar evidence of settlement. At Castell Henlis, a tiny hill fort on the Pembrokeshire coast, Phil Harding found a unique archaeological experiment into how Iron Age people may have lived.
Aren't these roundhouses incredible? And of course, what makes your collection so special is that they're actually rebuilt on the original footprints.
That's right, and this one in particular is the longest standing experimental Iron Age roundhouse in Britain.
How long's that?
26 years.
It's incredibly atmospheric in here, isn't it? Yeah. What's the actual structure made out of?
Well, there are lots of component parts. There's oak for the rafters. We've used hazel to weave around the posts for the walls. We've got river reed for the thatch, and also we've got clay and animal dung for the door.
Of course, the actual construction is totally hypothetical because all you start with is the post holes.
That's right, and that's the nature of the experimental archaeology that we're trying to do here.
Obviously, some buildings in the Iron Age were not maintained indefinitely because we see them being knocked down and replaced.
Yeah, that's the way the archaeological ground plan looks. The difficulty is we don't know how long each roundhouse lasted. Some of the work that we've done suggests that these could have lasted for generations.
We know that trade had been developing between communities in Britain and the continent since the Bronze Age, at least 4,000 years ago. And Castell Henlis wasn't some rural idyll cut off from the rest of the world. Excavations have shown that even this remote community was taking an active role in the developing commercial and political Iron Age landscape.
When they set up here, they were probably in charge of themselves, obviously had relationships and treaties with other people, but were largely small, independent political units. But by the late Iron Age, this site is abandoned as these people become part of a bigger political unit, and they're beginning to pay tribute and pay exchange and getting long-distance trade through acquiring surpluses of grain. And we begin to see at the very end of the hill fort that four-post granaries begin to be built here. And I think that's so that grain can be collected together, paid in tribute, and used for long-distance contact.
Ironwork from a larger hill fort on the Welsh border shows that these weren't only self-supporting people, they were also churning out state-of-the-art iron products, probably for trade.
We've got boxes and boxes and boxes from Croft Ambury excavations, and it shows you how much metalwork was actually being produced at the time.
So we've got the objects themselves. What's that?
That is a dagger blade. If you have a look at that, you can see the point going down here.
And then, oh, I see, iron socketed spearhead.
Yep.
Oh, now that is the obvious piece that attracts your eye, isn't it? Magnificent, big piece of sword.
What you've got is the actual tip part of it missing, but you've got a large portion of the length of it and also the tang for the handle.
Is this here, is this intricate decoration or is this corrosion?
That is corrosion. It looks like decoration, but that's the way the corrosion actually works. It comes spools off in circular lumps, really.
I mean, it's like an incredible level of sophistication to be able to make an object of that size.
Absolutely, yes. To actually make something like that, going from smelting the iron in the first place and getting your billet of iron, and then that would have to be worked at a hearth to produce a sword that had a good finish, was very much a high status object.
And of course they were doing it on site because you've got all the slag.
Absolutely. And they weren't only making these superb objects, they were also making utilitarian ones, which is interesting.
Oh, now, look at that. Isn't that gorgeous?
Now that is typical of the sort of pottery you get in the Welsh marches in the Iron Age, with the stamp decoration going around just below the rim. And in this case, you can see it's angled S's, a bit like snakes running around, and then the two lines, upper and lower, just sort of banded off around the rim.
Oh, and look, that bit's got a bit of iron stuck on it or something like that. Oh! No, it doesn't. It goes right the way through. Yep. There's a rivet.
It starts here and it goes through to the inside of the pot, and if you look a little bit further down, there's another bit of rivet there. And what that probably is actually a mend for the pot.
So the pot broke, but it was sufficiently important and valuable or usable enough that they took state-of-the-art object like iron and actually riveted it together.
As archaeologists discover more about these highly advanced Iron Age farming and manufacturing communities, they've started to question what was happening to a society where people were compelled to build hill forts.
The simplest explanation is that we're in a period of growing population, an increase of population, still living with the same technology and the same landscape. And there comes to a time when the nature of society sort of crystallizes in a different way because of this pressure. And one of the ways it might crystallize is in smaller groups wanting to define their own territories and wanting to create their place. A hill fort is essentially a place, a central place to which people relate.
The way you're describing it, it sounds like a bit of rather orderly social planning after the Second World War. But surely there would have been new elites rising up and revolutions and soldiers and blood and starvation.
Yeah, if your population is growing, undoubtedly your society is developing under stress. There is a stress factor comes in. So the hill forts could be seen as a reflection of that, which also provided defensive possibilities for the community at those times when the natural tension, the natural stress, burst out into open warfare. But I wouldn't see them as built because there was a state of warfare. they would be functional when the society was aggressive and there were tensions. And undoubtedly, some of them were attacked and destroyed. Danebury shows signs of at least two major fires. So I wouldn't rule out outright warfare and attack. I think it was there and there all the time, but not necessarily the only or even the most significant factor.
In the 1,000 years before the big wave of hill forts was built, communities were flourishing and expanding. So much so, it's estimated that Britain's population increased from 200,000 to over 1 million. There was bound to be conflict as everyone tried to grab the best farming land and create new boundaries. Hill forts were all about establishing power over place. But holding on to that place was always going to be a problem.
I think we're looking at a time before the state came into being. And states make war and states make peace. We're looking at communities who are living with insecurity as a fact of life. You go to bed in the evening not knowing if someone's going to be knocking on your door with bad intent in the middle of the night. Not knowing that the next time the dogs bark might be the time you're about to get attacked.
From the earliest times, any community worth its salt was defined by an earthwork. In the Iron Age, people set themselves up in more impressive locations, and the earthworks just got bigger. They were an expression of status and ownership in the landscape. But there was one more important factor.
Hill forts were designed to impress, and if you've ever tried to climb one, it'll make you wonder why prehistoric people would have bothered to do this every day, just for the privilege of living at the top.
Archaeologists now believe it was a privilege to be part of an ancient community. Only then could you survive the hardships, even the brutality of daily life. And taking part in building the ramparts would have been an essential ritual that confirmed your allegiance to that community. At Maiden Castle, the tribe was so powerful the banks and ditches were refreshed each year and further rings added as their status increased. Up until Mortimer Wheeler's time, there was still a belief that hill fort defences had been built by gang labour.
And the spoil has just been left.
But a look at the unfinished ramparts at this tiny hill fort on Ladle Hill in Hampshire suggests the job was much more of a community effort.
Perhaps each of these lengths represents one extended family unit, two or three generations perhaps, all coming up here and cooperating and being allocated one length to dig.
But why didn't they finish it?
Well, this is where we can have great fun as archaeologists, isn't it? Because we've got no written sources, so we can go from anything to alien abduction to rather more sensible suggestions that perhaps another location was decided upon. We don't know the full sort of power politics of that period, but it's quite possible. And there's a man comes along who says, there.
There's an unusually large cluster of hill forts on the border of England and Wales. Wales was plentiful in tin and copper used to make bronze. So a number of powerful groups may have developed here. At Credon Hill Camp in Herefordshire, a massive new dig has just begun. Credon Hill is, in fact, bigger than Maiden Castle. But we get no idea of the scale because the fortifications have been lost in the forest. Now, with the help of LIDAR, a sort of geophysics from the air, the tree cover can be stripped away to reveal the massive man-made ramparts underneath. This is the first time an excavation on this scale has taken place here. And helped by the latest scientific techniques, it's a unique opportunity to build up a much clearer picture of this once mysterious community. The first task is to find the earliest defences.
It's a magnificent location for a hill fort. And what are you hoping to find from your trenches?
Well, as you can see, there's a sort of bank here.
This is the one that's coming up here?
That's right.
So this is the bank of the earlier fort?
Well, the bank seems to come right the way through here on the break of slope. And then comes down, levels out here, and then is cut by the quarry ditch for the later phase of the fort.
That is the bank of the later fort shrouded in trees.
That's right, and all the area, we think, between that bank and the bank where we're on here is quarry ditch.
The Credon Hill dig will go on for three seasons, and hopes are high because other hill fort excavations have shown there were well-developed Iron Age groups scattered right along the Welsh border. But these diggers have to be prepared for some shocking discoveries as a darker, more sinister aspect of Iron Age society has started to emerge. In a brutal time when human life was cheap, these were people living in constant fear of their gods.
Classical writers talk about foretelling the future by watching how people die.
So together we brought Time Team back, and now we're going to take Time Team to the next level. Help us achieve 10,000 ongoing members on Patreon.
We've seen that some hill forts were built on tribal boundaries or were big statements in the landscape, and others weren't much more than farmers' retreats. But were some of them built for much more mystical reasons?
The more we learn about ancient monuments, the more we realise how many Iron Age hill forts were built on much older sacred sites. This spectacular hill fort at Hambledon Hill in Dorset has a Neolithic burial mound on top that's nearly 5,000 years old. People would have been gathering at this hallowed place from miles around to commune with their ancestors for 1,000 generations before the Iron Age stronghold was built. These extraordinary ramparts would not only have made the hill look more sacred from a distance, they would also have magnified the spiritual power and significance of this monument. Scholars such as Barry Cunliffe think the gods were an all-powerful influence on ancient people's lives.
In the Iron Age, I think everything was bound around with magic and behaviour that related to the gods. You were always looking over your shoulder to see whether the gods were happy with what you're doing.
I half wondered if it was divine intervention that had brought me to one of the most spiritual yet improbable hill fort locations in Britain.
You're winding me up. You have to be winding me up. There can't be a hill fort here. This is the flattest part of Britain. There's not a hill within 50 miles.
But Francis was serious. This hill fort was barely half a metre above sea level.
To a fenman, there are hills. I mean, look, we're coming up to a positive mountain. But I mean, in the Iron Age, all of these fields around here would have been underwater, except for this little higher bit we're coming to here. So that's where they put a hill fort.
When Stony Camp in Cambridgeshire was excavated, some of the finds were startling. As local archaeologist Ben Robinson and Iron Age expert J.D. Hill told me,
in Iron Age Britain, the wild is a very special, potentially dangerous place. So here we are standing on the end of a tiny island in the middle of the Fenland Marshes. And this would perhaps have been a very magical ritual place. And perhaps that's what this monument is all about.
Is there any evidence that you found that might tell us what was going on here?
Yeah, the really curious thing is you'd expect to find lots of animal bone, lots of pottery and stuff like that. We didn't get that sort of thing, but we got quite a lot of human remains and human bone. Now, human bone is littered around Iron Age settlements, but to find a lot more human remains than animal remains, that's something really a little bit weird.
Britain's flattest hill fort was an outpost of Boudicca's Iceni tribe. And we're told several skirmishes with the Romans took place here.
This one looks very young.
But that didn't explain the gruesome discovery of a small skull.
Yeah, probably about 4 years old, just a young child.
Do we know how it died?
Well, yeah, in this case we do. It's very, very sad. I mean, there's two huge wounds on this skull, a glancing blow at the back here. Can you see that just running through there, and another great slash across the side of the skull here.
So the person who did this virtually cut off the child's face.
Yes, a horrible thing to think about, isn't it?
JD, do you think these are bones that were just chucked away, or do you think they were put here deliberately?
You get a lot of human remains in East Anglia, often which have been cut around with swords, and they're almost always found in the ditches around settlements, around monuments. It's almost as if the right place to put human bodies and bits of human bodies is in the ditch. And often these are people who've been deliberately killed. And there's a very strong, strong argument to be made that this is human sacrifice.
This must have been a very weird place in the Iron Age. We've no idea if sacrificing fellow humans and putting them in the ramparts was an attempt to keep the evil Fenland spirits out or to protect the people inside.
I think one of the interesting aspects that we find at this time in the Iron Age is there's an interest in foundation deposits, and we have a small number, admittedly, of foundation burials within settlements, and some of them occur underneath the ramparts of hill forts. You could see this as all part of founding a new place. The other thing that I think keeps coming across time and time again, whether we're looking at enclosures or even the houses themselves, it's the significance of the boundary between inside and outside, which is absolutely crucial for understanding the Iron Age.
Even in prehistory, it was important to be on the right side of the tracks. And archaeologists realised the more they understood about Iron Age religious beliefs and practices, the greater their grasp of people's lifestyle would be, particularly in hill forts. And it turns out that the clues have been lying around in amongst the most prosaic finds.
In the past, when we've dug up potsherds, animal bones, broken rubbish, we would have simply said that's rubbish. But we now are beginning to recognise that an awful lot of the evidence you dig up on a hill fort or an Iron Age farm has been put there for deliberate reasons, and those deliberate reasons are actually to do with religious rituals and activities.
J.D. Hill's outstanding research has turned the archaeology of rubbish on its head.
People are deliberately taking rubbish, bits from perhaps animal sacrifices, bits of broken material, and they're placing these things in the ground as offerings to the gods. And that's just one example. You know, we know that Iron Age houses face in certain directions, not simply to get out of the winds, but to actually face the rising sun. Almost all aspects of an Iron Age settlement, the layout of a hill fort's interior, seems to be, at least in some way, guided by their religious ideas and principles and mythologies.
Barry Cunliffe believes one of the most powerful places to make an offering to the gods would have been at the bottom of a pit, used to store vital food resources or to protect next year's seed crop. Digging a pit was likely to offend the gods of the underworld because it invaded divine space. This was supported by his work at Danebury.
The whole of the inside was peppered with storage pits, where they probably kept their seed corn. When they'd taken their seed corn out and sown it in the fields around, they then made an offering to the deity. Might be a piece of meat on the bone, as it were. Might be a quernstone for grinding grain, or a pot with, likes to think, beer or honey or something in it. But some sort of offering. So everything they did was embedded in ritual and practice, which probably goes back hundreds of generations.
Sometimes the gods wanted more.
We had single skulls, which might have been trophies. We had some pits where a complete body was articulated, was just thrown down into the pit, lay spread eagle on the bottom, flints piled on top. You could say that that was disposal of the body. But it could have been a human, it could have been a sacrifice, you know, a human put down there and stoned to death. And classical writers talk about foretelling the future by watching how people die.
And the gods had a thirst for justice.
We found one particularly nasty piece, which was the pelvis of a young man, and his legs had been chopped off. The tops of the thighs were still there. He'd been sliced through the middle.
And that pelvis, sort of dripping, would have been just placed in the middle of the pit for some reason. And presumably he did something that people didn't like. So an essential part of his body was put in the pit.
Only half the surface area was excavated at Danebury. So many more such secrets must still lie undisturbed. From extensive work at Stonehenge and in the Orkneys, it's clear that ritual and religion weren't just limited to monuments. Whole landscapes were sacred. Time Team Stuart Ainsworth and his English Heritage colleagues have surveyed over 100 hill forts in the Cheviot Hills on the border between England and Scotland. Stuart believes people have been worshipping here since the Neolithic period, 5,000 years ago. The focal point is Yevering Bell. It sticks out like a cathedral in the landscape.
We've got continuity, I think, on here, possibly even from the Neolithic period. I mean, for instance, we're actually standing on the remains of what was a Bronze Age burial cairn on top of this hill. And that shows there's been Bronze Age activity up here. But we've also got a lot of Neolithic activity out in the plain out there where the two major river valleys come together.
Now, I mean, we've got that modern cairn, and that was built by walkers carrying rocks from down below. But what about those rock ramparts? Were they built that way?
Well, you call them rock ramparts. They're actually stone walls. They're massive dry stone walls. Originally, they'd be 2.5 metres high, 6 foot thick. And although the stone now looks grey, when that's freshly quarried, it's actually bright pink. Can you imagine what that would look like to people living down there and worshipping down there and living all in the landscape round about? Like this monumental pink beacon on this massive hill, it would dominate the landscape.
From the lumps and bumps, it's just possible to see the shadows of a huge community on Yevering Bell. But it's impossible to tell if this hill fort would have supported a permanent settlement or whether it was only used for religious festivals. Most of the people who worshipped at Yevering Bell would have been from shepherding families. Several of their farmsteads are described on the maps as hill forts. So it seems that nothing's really changed since antiquarian times.
We are going from the sublime, which is Yevering Bell, a massive hill port, to the ridiculous, which is this site here. I mean, clearly it's got these big ramparts on one side of it, but when you get here, it's very small. There's only room for three houses inside, which we can see the remains of. What we've got is a small family farmstead of the Iron Age here. And what these fancy ramparts are on this side are the Iron Age equivalent of modern suburban stone cladding, effectively. They're showing off to one side that you approach on. When you get round the back, it's not defensible. It's not a hill fort. It's an enclosure that's starting to have pretensions and show off. If you go down to the entrance and look through the entrance, what do you see through it? You see Yevering Bell up on the hill there. That's where your masters are. That's the power in this area.
Just like Yevering Bell in the Cheviots, the White Horse in Oxfordshire dominates the landscape. It too is some sort of shrine or spiritual meeting place.
People have suggested it's everything from a kind of ferret to a greyhound by way of a dragon.
It sits close to the Ridgeway, the most ancient route in Britain.
At this particular period, these people, whether you want to call them Celts or Iron Age Britons, they would have regarded the horse as a symbol of power, as a deity, as a sky god. And I think they deliberately carved this horse here as a banner to reflect the power of the tribe that lived here.
David, we've long known that the White Horse is ancient, but just how old is it?
We know that in the Middle Ages it was here and it was regarded as one of the wonders of Britain, so it's old. The big question was, how old? Fortunately, we came up with a new dating technique a few years ago called, and I'm sorry about the jargon, it's called optical stimulated luminescence, or OSL dating. In the body of the horse, there are silts that have accumulated on the surface of the old horse. And the silts include crystals,
And those crystals accumulate radiation. And what you can do is measure the amount of accumulated radiation since it was last exposed to the sun. In fact, the dates suggest that it belongs to the end of the Bronze Age, beginning of the Iron Age, somewhere around about 800, 700 BC. And of course, you can see this spot for miles around. And I think it's probably at the junction of tribal boundaries as well. In other words, you put your monument up here and you announce to that lot over there that we're here. This is our land.
Is that why you think they put a hill fort alongside it?
Probably. And of course, the interesting thing is it, the hill fort seems perhaps to be more to do with symbolism, festivals, religion, than it does to do with, you know, being a straightforward village, for example. It's not like some of the other densely occupied hill forts.
For centuries, antiquarians, historians and archaeologists have been trying to explain the connection between the White Horse, the Ridgeway and the hill fort. But the exact purpose of the hill fort is still a mystery.
Excavation shown that at this site at Uffington, people didn't really live here. There was quite a lot of activity in various different ways, pits and post holes. But possibly a major element of being here was a statement on the landscape, that there were quite large wooden revetments of the hill fort itself. And Uffington is very visible from 360 degrees around. So it's as if people were marking their presence here. And it's hard at the moment to imagine, but these ramparts and so on would have been much higher than they are today, and possibly lime-washed. So people looking from the valley or from around and about would have seen this place, and it would have marked the landscape in a pretty dramatic sort of way.
The hill fort carried on being used well into the Victorian times as a meeting place for pagan fairs and festivities that commemorated the power and mysticism of this site. But in different parts of the country, other hill forts were to take on a new importance and keep their power in surprising ways.
Join a thriving worldwide community of Time Team fans on Patreon. Your ongoing membership enables us to develop more sites and more episodes.
Hill forts managed to conceal their secrets for centuries. First they were overlooked, and then they were misunderstood. And it's only recently that these enigmatic earthworks have been recognised as the remains of powerful and sophisticated Iron Age societies. A few hill forts have retained their celebrity status to this day by the very legend surrounding them. Maiden Castle, of course, has survived because of its size and its connection with the Romans. Cadbury Castle, just a few miles from Glastonbury, was identified by the first antiquarians as the site of Camelot, the court of King Arthur. And, not surprisingly, the myth is perpetuated to this day. And the name Caractacus, an Iron Age warrior king, keeps cropping up along the Welsh border. According to the Roman histories, Caractacus was defeated and taken back to Rome as a trophy. The most powerful hill fort in this area is British Camp, carved out of the Malvern Hills. According to legend, it was where the great British chieftain was captured.
Had Caractacus been here, it would have been a hell of a position to defend against the Romans.
It would have been a lot easier than many others, yeah.
If my eyes don't deceive me, are those scallops in the hillside over there, are they hut platforms?
They're all stances for huts, and in a recent English Heritage survey, they found over 100 of them here, and it's where they would have had houses, granaries, and other sort of structures.
So there'd have been an immense population up here?
Well, certainly periodically, yes, not necessarily full time.
And when you look at it, an Iron Age stronghold like this on British Camp reminds me of the keep of a medieval castle, the innermost defence, that wouldn't appear for another 1,000 years. The hill fort was probably the forerunner of the castle, almost providing a blueprint for the structured life inside. Barry Cunliffe suggests that just like castles, Hill forts were occupied by tribal chiefs or kings in the late Iron Age, surrounded by their elite group of skilled supporters, or loyal knights as we understand them today. Outside the hill fort, you would have found the labourers or serfs. This could be the earliest form of feudalism, or possibly even the first glimpse of our class system. Many medieval castles have traced their origins back to the Iron Age. Bamborough Castle, not far from Yeavering Bell in Northumberland, was once a powerful promontory fort that controlled the coastal trading routes.
This place obviously is very important. But then, so again, you know, Yeavering Bell is very important. Are they similar in any respect?
Well, I think, a few years ago, for instance, we would have said that Yeavering Bell was the centre of a massive tribal area covering most of the northern England where we are now. It was the centre of the Votadinian tribe. It was covering a huge area. What we say now from research is that we're thinking that the area is divided up into much smaller tribal kingdoms, each with its own warrior chief, effectively. And at Yeavering Bell, you'd have a tribal chief controlling the major confluence of the river valleys and the Millfield Basin and the high ground that way. And here at Banbury, you'd have another tribal centre, which is effectively controlling the major seaways. Each is a centre of power, but it's a much smaller division across the landscape.
So the smaller tribal centres compete amongst themselves. And then eventually one rises to the top, like Maiden Castle in Dorset. Here, it could either be Bamborough or Yeavering Bell. Which one are we to choose?
Well, I think it has to be here at Bamborough, because Yeavering is effectively abandoned, whereas here at Bamborough we've got continuity. We've got from the Iron Age, we go through into the Roman period, we've got occupation from the Saxon, continues through into the medieval period and so on, continuing. And we've still got a village and settlement thriving here, a royal castle. This continues on and on. This is clearly establishing as a major power base right through into the later landscape.
Most hill forts were abandoned as politics and economics changed. Smaller groups were absorbed by more powerful, wealthier tribes. And so by the end of the Iron Age, Britain had spawned a number of powerful regional kingdoms. Many hill forts were either ploughed away or absorbed into modern built-up areas. But the legacy of the hill fort can't be underestimated. Many gaps in British history have been filled due to the work done on hill forts. We might not have discovered that the Iron Age was a period of such social and industrial change, with people living together in towns long before the Romans brought us roads. But even without the history, it's pretty awe-inspiring having some of these magnificent strongholds still holding their place in the British landscape.
We've come a long way since people were building places like Maiden Castle and British Camp, haven't we? Well, there is another way of looking at it. Here we are in the middle of our great tribal centre, London. Over there is the giant gateway designed to impress. Here you can see the massive storage places where we keep our corn and our precious metals. And over here is the big roundhouse where the tribe chief Boris Johnson hangs out. And if all this isn't about domination, control, and making a statement in the landscape, I don't know what is. Things don't change that much, do they? Join Time Team on Patreon to access exclusive 3D models, masterclasses, and behind-the-scenes insights.